Friends, this is our 75th Platinum Friday meeting. Even myself surprised how these all these years went, is 2.5 years, even myself. In the Friday group, I posted everything about several speakers, including Basan sir, Markande sir, youngsters. So you can watch in our Friday group who are all in the smartphones in the group. That is one thing. Today's speaker, the subject is the Land Acquisition Act. A speaker name already has circulated. Again, Shekhar Naphade sir, senior advocate. He did his LLM from Bombay University, designated as senior advocate from Bombay High Court, and sometime professor in law college, in Bombay Law College. Practice started in Bombay. Now he is a senior advocate here, and he appears some in Karnataka and Tamil Nadu Kaveri disputes. Yes, sir. Sir, now you can initiate, sir. Please. 1 second, sir.
Can I start?
Yes, yeah, sir. Please, sir.
Loud and clear. Good afternoon to everybody. First, let me congratulate you all. This is something which the bar is supposed to do, and I'm glad to know that you are doing so with such consistency and perseverance. Kabile tarif hai. Let's come to the subject. Probably you are all interested first in knowing the fate of Section 24.
Yes.
But in my view, it's a small aspect of the whole law. We'll definitely deal with that. But when you construe a particular statutory provision, you must have before you a proper perspective. Now, this new act has certain unique features. Some of them are extremely good, beneficial to the landowners, but some of the provisions are going to be problematic. First, let me place before you a few questions. Acquisition of land is a subject which is in the concurrent list. Therefore, both Parliament and state legislatures are competent to enact laws. If you see some of the provisions of this Act, they cover even several aspects of the state laws dealing with town and country planning. Now, all the state laws have received the presidential assent under Article 254, Clause 2. But the proviso to 254(2) tells us that notwithstanding the presidential assent, if subsequently on the same subject matter the Parliament enacts a law, then the state law becomes void, provided it is repugnant. There could be implied repeal or there could be express repeal. Now, as far as this Act is concerned, it does not expressly repeal any of the state laws, because in every state law dealing with town and country planning, there is a provision for acquisition of land. Whether you take Maharashtra Regional Town Planning Act or Gujarat Town Planning Act or Bangalore Development Act or Karnataka Town and Country Planning Act or any other statute obtaining in any other state, there are two things in the state laws. Number one, you have the concept of a development plan, regional plan, town planning scheme, development scheme, master plan. Though the state laws have used different expressions, they all mean the same thing, which means the planned development of a given area. In Delhi, we call it master plan. In Karnataka, you call it development scheme. In Gujarat, you call it town planning scheme. So on and so forth. Now, this concept of planned development is also contemplated by Section 2 of the new Act. Now, does it or does it not cover the same subject matter? And if you see the modality of acquisition of land under this Act and the modality of acquisition of land under the state laws, you will definitely come to the conclusion that those provisions are not consistent. In several respects, they are repugnant, both on the question of compensation and also on the question of procedure to be followed. Now, I'll give you one example. Now, under this Act, except of course, if it is what we call as the urgency clause, which is under old Section 17 and which is Section 40 under the new Act. Otherwise, there is an elaborate procedure here. What is that? You begin with first a study of social impact assessment. Now, several parameters are prescribed for that. And that social impact assessment must also go on with environment impact assessment. Now, there is going to be a possible conflict between the two. I don't know how it is going to be resolved, but this is one question that comes to my mind. Because as far as environment impact assessment is concerned, you have the parameters under the environment law. As far as the social impact assessment is concerned, you have the parameters under this Act, and I can't say that the parameters are congruent. They may be in conflict in several situations. That's one question which comes to my mind. The second question is that first the study is prepared. After that study is prepared, there is a report. After that report is prepared, it goes to another expert body for appraisal. After that appraisal, government under Section 8 decides whether the land is required or not. Then the preliminary notification under Section 11. Now, Section 11 of the present Act, one can say, is a counterpart of Section 4 of the old Act. But Section 4 did not precede by the social impact assessment, nor did it precede by environment impact assessment. You straight away, where the government is of the opinion that land is required, you issue notice in Section 4. Now here, therefore, first is this elaborate procedure of study, report, appraisal of that report, and then again government considering under 8. So too many authorities, perhaps it's a case of too many cooks spoiling the broth. After Section 11, then notices are issued, then award is made, etc. Of course, there is a time frame, which is a very good thing. Very tight time frame is there. But that tight time frame also can create problems. If within 12 months of the social impact assessment appraisal, which is done under Section 7, Section 11 notification is not issued, then the social impact assessment lapses. Such a detailed study comes to an end. Now look at the sequence of events and look at the efficiency of Indian administration. How is it going to be workable? It's going to be a serious problem. Now, extremely salutary provision is with regard to the compensation. This is, I should say, after many, many years, justice is brought to the landowner. First, you determine the compensation. The parameters for determining the compensation are almost same as the old Act. But the revolutionary measure is contained in the first schedule. You first decide the compensation, and there is a multiplier in the first schedule. So X amount of compensation is first determined, and then it is to be multiplied by multiplier given in the first schedule. So the quantum of compensation goes up. Now this is an extremely salutary and beneficial provision. Now, the other aspects. See, the old Land Acquisition Act, you had a simple method, Section 4, Section 6, Section 9, Section 11, and then came Section 11A. But here, there are too many things. Not all of them are bad. Now, another beneficial provision, which is to be found, is preparation of a rehabilitation scheme. Now this rehabilitation scheme is with respect to people who are affected by a given project. In several states, we had laws dealing with rehabilitation of project affected persons. Initially, all those state laws started with farmers who were affected by irrigation projects, whose land was acquired and their land submerged in the irrigation project, and they had to be rehabilitated because the quantum of compensation that they get at the end of 2 years, they become paupers, so they must get some land so they continue their profession or vocation. Now, this scheme is sought to be introduced in the new Act. But this scheme does not apply to every case of acquisition. It applies where the land is acquired for a public purpose, and that public purpose is to be achieved through private enterprise or through public-private partnership. This is the rider. Now who prepares? Again, there are detailed provisions. First, you have the survey by the administrator who prepares a draft scheme. Then you have the draft scheme vetted by the collector who submits it to the commissioner. Then it goes to the government. Now look at the four-tier mechanism. Now I am worried about this four-tier mechanism because at every state there will be delay. And all state laws dealing with this subject matter, our results are not good. The state administration, because ultimately whether the project is by state government or by a central government, it is ultimately the state machinery which is going to implement. And the performance of the state machinery across the country with regard to project affected people rehabilitation is not something that inspires confidence. So merely because we have now enacted a new law, it does not mean that overnight we are going to have a qualitative change in the administrative setup. So this is my comment as far as, but the measure is good. Earlier it was only confined to irrigation projects. Now the scope is widened, it takes in its compass wherever there is public-private. Now there is another problem as far as private enterprise is concerned. One, that if it is public-private partnership for a project, then you must have the consent of 70% of the persons. Now, I don't know how this is going to work. This seems to be a thoughtless provision. And not only thoughtless, it is, in my view, inconsistent with the very concept of acquisition. Because the concept of acquisition is a reflection of the state's power of eminent domain. The power of eminent domain is exercised all over the world for last several centuries. Now, if you are going to bring in an element of consent of 70% people for a public-private partnership project, I am sure there is going to be delay. And if it is purely private but a public purpose, like the old acquisition for the companies, then you require 80%. Now, let me tell you my experience. Whenever there were proposals for acquisition of land in the country for a public purpose or for a company, the local politicians become active. And then there are processions, morchas, dharnas, and again we will have the same problem. Now something has got to be done under the new regime. How quickly can you? Because the problem is that the costs go up, the question of escalation of costs. And not only that, as the time passes by, because unless you prepare a scheme, unless you have this, all these things done, social impact, is, then again the question of compensation also goes. So it's a vicious circle. And therefore, though the idea that there should be consent of the landowners seems to be a good idea on the paper, but I'm sure. Now suppose 78% of the people give consent. They are all reasonable people like you and me. But 2% people can hold the entire project to ransom. And the 2% fellows can hold the entire country to ransom. This is therefore a provision which in my view requires to be recast. See, for example, in some of the state laws, there is a provision that the acquisition will be through an agreement. Of course, even though the statutory provision is not there, the state as a person can always enter into a contract with anybody and buy the property. But some of the states are experimenting. Either through a mechanism of exchange, voluntary consent, that I take your 1 acre here and we give you 1 acre another place, or 2 acres at another place, so that there is no immediate burden on the public resource, financial resources. Or there is a concept known as the transferable development rights. That's, suppose in your plot at South X, you have X potential to construct, then you are shifted to, say, Patganj, and where you are given potential 1.5 times that of the South. So some such mechanism, the several state laws are experimenting with that, and I think that kind of mechanism is more appropriate than this consent business, because in consent a few people can be serious roadblocks. So this is as far as a broad framework of the present act is concerned. Now we come to 24. And what is the controversy? First, let me tell you, there are three important aspects which are still not before the Constitutional Bench. And we are going to have this problem sooner or later. Number one, some of the state laws which deal with town and country planning, they have a mechanism for land acquisition. The first question to which I made a reference earlier was whether those provisions survive in view of proviso to Article 254(2). The question is not that simple, whether it constitutes an implied repeal. This question is going to come up, if not today, tomorrow. That's question number one, which is not before. The second question, assuming that the state laws are valid, then the question will be whether an acquisition through the state law, is it covered by 24? This second question is going to come. Right now, actually, I am arguing this point before somebody. The view taken by the High Court is that since the acquisition is under a state law, Section 24, because Section 24 uses the word where the proposal is initiated under the Land Acquisition Act. Now, what is initiated is going to be a matter of debate. That's question number two, which is going to come. Question number three, it says compensation is not paid or possession is not taken. Now, whether these or is or is and, that's going to be a debate. Neither in Pune Municipal Corporation case nor in Indore development this aspect is touched. So this is the third question which is going to come sooner or later, and you will require, probably, in my view, all these questions, wherever if your matters are pending, should be brought to the notice of the Chief Justice so that we don't repeat the recent experience, one bench saying that the judgment of another bench is per incurio. This is something which is very disturbing. Now let me come to the controversy. See, under Section 31 of the old Act, the compensation has to be tendered. Now, after the award, the collector gives a notice under Section 12 of the old Act. Now, do we follow the principle of the common law, whether Section 12 and the whole mechanism of the Land Acquisition Act 1894, does it contain the common law principle that the debtor must seek the creditor? What is that principle? If in the absence of an agreement, where a debtor has borrowed the money from the creditor, the debtor must seek the creditor and give it to him. If he is in Delhi, must go to in Delhi and pay it to him. This is a common law principle. Now, once the collector tells you that the award is made and notice is given to you too, now, is it necessary for the collector to come to your own house and say, Mr., take the money? Applying the common law principle of debtor must seek the creditor, in my view, it is not. Because to that extent, in a strict sense of the term, the state is not a debtor, in that sense of the term. I don't want to go into the detailed discussion on that point. Now, what was missed in Pune Municipal Corporation is two things. Now, he knows that the award is passed. He makes no attempt to collect the compensation amount. He knows the award is passed. He knows he's right. And after years, he says, now compensation is not paid. Does it not amount to acquiescence? Waiver. According to me, even you need not go to the principle of acquiescence or waiver. You know that award has been passed. You know you are entitled to. If you go and ask for, or if you make a simple demand by a simple letter and then state fails, then I can understand compensation is not paid. Now, what is the view taken in Pune Municipal Corporation case, which according to me is patently incorrect? that compensation amount is deposited in the treasury and not in the court. Suppose there is no reference, so where is the question of there being deposited in the court? I can understand deposit in the court if there is a reference under 18 of the old Act, section 30, that is the apportionment of compensation. I can understand that. But if there is neither a reference under 18 nor a reference under section 30 of the old Act, where is the question of amount being deposited, not considered? The second aspect on which I find fault with that judgment is that anyone who knows some elementary things about deposit in the treasury, there is always a challan. You just can't put the money. There is a challan. And that challan gives you details. This amount which is being deposited in the treasury is on what count? It says that this is on count of acquisition of land in award, so and so, all details are there. So what is the difference between deposit in the treasury and the deposit in the court? I see none in principle. Now this is a serious flaw in Pune Municipal Corporation. First, the second is the court has not examined whether that or is and, because according to me, there is one well-known principle in law that the legislature does not make too radical a departure from the existing law unless there is an express provision or by necessary implication. Now, as far as the whole mechanism of acquisition is concerned, social impact assessment, its appraisal, then etc., there is a radical departure from the old Act. There is no doubt about it. Compensation determination, radical departure from the existing law. Now look at some of the old provisions, section 16. That once possession is taken, the land stands vested. It involves two things. The original landowner is divested of his title and there is vesting. So there is a vestative transaction and there is a divestative transaction. Now look at the new law. Does it really contemplate that if possession is not taken but compensation is paid? I am taking the another example. Now something which is vested under section 16 of the old Act, will it stand divested? Now this is one aspect, because the Pune Municipal Corporation proceeds on an assumption that they are all. And if you go through any standard book on interpretation of statutes, you will find several judgments saying that or can be read as and, it all contextual. So if you apply this test of not too radical a departure is contemplated from the existing law, in my view, that or has to be read as and. So both conditions must be, because you are doing away with wasting. Now this is too serious a consequence, and especially so in the light of the fact that the acquisition is for a public purpose. So therefore, on my humble opinion, Pune Municipal Corporation was not rightly decided. Now we come to Indore. That does not mean Indore is rightly decided. Now let me tell you what is wrong with Indore. First of all, it's too long a judgment. And if you carefully examine the judgment, you will find contradictions within. First, they say that Pune Municipal Corporation is arbiter. Their observations is arbiter. Then they say it is per incurium. Now what is arbiter can never be per incurium, because arbiter is never binding on you as on a coordinate bench. It may be binding on high court or subordinate courts. It is never binding on a coordinate bench. So that is the first flaw I find. The second flaw which I find is that for years together, if the person comes and asks for compensation and if that is not paid to him, which very often happens in rural areas, how such a grievance is to be redressed? This is another aspect. Third aspect which is not considered is the tehsildars sit in their office and take possession. A pernicious practice. This has to be. They say that Panchanama is good enough. Or even entry in the revenue records is good enough. Now, let me say how the judgment suffers from contradiction. First, they say that in Pune Municipal Corporation, the court has ignored the past practices. That's the first fault. All right. Let's assume that it is correct. Now, the past practice, that was as regards compensation and possession. But as regards possession, the past practice, the courts have said that you must take physical possession. Now, that past practice is not recognized in the by Indore development. Now, these are, but on one point Indore development is right, and that is on old section 31 and present section 77, that once the amount is tendered, there is no requirement of payment. That, as far as that ratio of Indore is concerned, I think it is unassailable. So, I repeat, three important issues are still left out. And how the course of litigation will decide whether these issues reach the constitution bench or not, or do we live still in a lawyer's paradise where one bench takes a view, another bench takes a view. But the bar must be united on one issue, that no bench, coordinate bench, should ever take a stand that the judgment of another is perfect. See, this would be an antithesis of rule of law. Because the third bench can say that the second bench, which said that earlier bench judgment is per incurium, they can say that that judgment is per. And this can, ultimately the litigants will suffer. Of course, we will prosper because too many courts and too many views. But then the court would not be an institution. And the court as an institution is the first hallmark is that it says what it means and it means what it says. But if there are divergent voices, then we live in a Tower of Babel, then nobody knows what the law on the subject is, including the rest of us. Thank you.
Question answers. Any questions, please, Aman?
Sir, only the question regarding the deposit. If the Pune Municipal Corporation has said, it means that you are taking my property and keeping money with you yourself. Then I have been deprived money as well as the property. They wanted to reconcile of this, that if you have taken my property, say the ordinary law, even section 54 of the Transfer of Property Act, if you have taken my property, I have a right to take money. Maybe sale may not be void, but I have every right to have the money. So the money has not been offered to me. It's only to deposit it in another wing of the government. So does it not that they're taking property and usurping my money, so therefore your acquisition is bad?
See, let me answer that.
Yes.
The award is made under 11. 11A is only the time frame within which the award has passed. then after the award, the collector has to give you notice and referral. So if you have received the notice and you don't do anything, what does that mean? That you are resisting, and you will find invariably all the cases which came before the court under 24(2) were cases where people were resisting the acquisition under one count or the other. Those were not the genuine cases where they were interested in getting the compensation and the state had denied that right. See, we have to see the larger public interest also. Once there is a notice to you under section 12, yes, according to me, it complies with the obligation of the state. And that principal debtor must seek the creditor will not apply here. That amounts to tender.
No, that says that award is a final. If suppose I have any grievances against the quantum or whatever, then I can refer 18. To section 18. Yeah, I have no grievances. Does it mean that you will not offer money to me?
No, but 12 is notice to you, no?
That's correct. Yes. Award is final. But I don't want to challenge.
After notice under 12, what do? You are resisting the acquisition.
No, I'm not resisting.
All those cases which came under 24, they were resisting for years and years. They from this court, that court, then the question arose where there is a stay, whether that is to be excluded or not. Like 11A, because there was no provision like 11A under 24. But according to me, the act of court cannot do injustice to anybody. That's a well-known maxim. And therefore, once the court stays, that means there was no acquisition proceedings in process. And therefore, there is no question of delay.
Sir,
you will have to possibly do like this.
Okay.
Now EIA and SIA, Environment Impact Assessment Report, in my humble view, it's not a question, it's a comment. Environment Impact Assessment Report will prevail over Social Impact Assessment Report.
Undoubtedly.
And that is what has been happening under 142 years. That's all.
No, even otherwise. The notifications are clear. The all environment notifications are clear that no project will be undertaken without environmental clearance first. And secondly, it is the principle of primacy of the federal law. Because all these questions arise with reference to the state laws relating to town and country planning. Unless now the Supreme Court takes a view that all state laws go by virtue of the new act, that's a serious question which will arise. Because one of the items is land required for town and country planning. And if you see some of the projects which are enumerated, there was no need, but those projects clearly fall within the ambit of planned development of the city.
Supplementary comment of one line. There is Article 243 now in the Constitution, which possibly will help EIA report prevail over SIA.
There is no doubt about that.
Yeah, Nedu.
Sir, my question was that because of the old, there is fallacies in old act, and it is anti-claimant's right of the act, for which alone that new act has come. By the parliament in its wisdom, it has brought a new legislation now. They might have contemplated about the pendency of the acquisition proceedings also. That is why they introduced that provision of either to payment of the award amount or taking over possession. Why that confusion? Is it not a confusion created by the mere advocacy, or is it really there is in the enactment, there is a flaw in the enactment? Even go to the extent of the word R is used, so it clearly states either this or that. If that is the beneficial legislation given to the claimant, why it is looked at into such a different manner as if he had lost every right by this new act?
I will tell you a point in your favor, and I will tell you also a point against you. Number one, every law dealing with acquisition of land is an expropriation measure. So I am putting it in the communist words. Or the how the capitalist would look at any law which. So the settled viewpoint is that any such expropriation law must be strictly construed. That's one principle. No difficulty on that score. And therefore that or must be read as or. But now the question that arises in my mind is that if you read or as or, where the, you have received the amount, for one reason or the other, the state has not taken possession. And then you are eating the cake and have it too. You get my point. Now the state has parted with money. You have lost the title. And now after so many years we say you have not taken possession. And let me tell you one thing. In Indian administration, things can be easily managed. If you see the whole history of disputes, litigation relating to land acquisition, the local tehsildars, etc., play a vital role. They prepare reports in such a way that it gives an impression to the court that possession is not taken. Why? You know. Therefore, you have to weigh against two things. So if your interpretation is accepted, so even though you have received the amount and if possession is not taken, look at the consequences. So in a way, any acquisition for a public purpose, I don't consider such a law as expropriation law.
Sir, again, the compensation and possession, I am retaining the possession. In those cases where, suppose the payment is actually, it is like depositing in the treasury, of like that, as if it is, though it is now, the recent law is construing that deposit as per the rule, it is a payment. Is it not that the legislature is taken care of that only by using that word or to that, because of this type of compensation paid only on paper, possession, same way that possession was actually taken on paper, not actual payment or actual possession.
See, ultimately my view is that this possession can't be carried too far. This is the unfortunate aspect of land acquisition law. After all, the state is paying money. What difference does it make whether they have taken possession or not? Because you have received your money. This drafting is defective. We need to change that provision. Simple. After award is made, the compensation should be offered within so and so period. And if it is not offered, then it is deemed to have been refused. Something like I can understand.
Sir, just one. It can be infused into his bank account.
Yeah.
Or tendered by way of a check.
So, sir, what did I say? But all this litigation is by people who have been resisting the acquisition. That is the fault which I find in Pune Municipal Corporation.
Your experience is largely in Maharashtra, Karnataka and all those states which are, but in Uttar Pradesh where the landowner is very poor and illiterate, experience is on the other side. Section 17 used to be invariably in every case invoked and upheld right up to Supreme Court.
Yes.
Although they used to sleep over the whole matter till the last day. Under declaration under Section 6 has to be issued within 1 year. On the last day they would obtain and meanwhile, you know, the landowner has been deprived of land, its produce, its everything.
I quite agree with you.
And what you said was very correct, that all these tehsildars sitting in their offices used to take the possession without
not
money.
Actual on paper.
Sir, one thing must be very made very clear, that when the landowner loses his land, he not only loses the property, land is a property, but also his right to livelihood, and further, because he has to marry daughters, he has to send children to universities, he must also come up in life.
Position in the society also.
So sir, my, from whatever little experience I have, the system in UAE is very, the officer is supposed to go to the landowner and say, yes, Mr. such and such, how much do you value your land? He says 10,000. So okay, there's a check of 10,001. Please vacate the land, go in shed number such and such where you have your temporary habitat. There has to be some mechanism whereby it should be equally good to the landowner. As you know, the Land Acquisition Act was passed by the British to appropriate our land. And as you know, Riyadh had no say in the matter. So to that extent, the new act is a... But new act has so many impediments to acquisition that in a very important project, the acquisition is retarded, is postponed, made absolutely, and costs escalate in the meanwhile.
Okay.
So a balance has to be struck.
There is no doubt about it. But I'll just answer your question in a slightly different context. If you see the litigation between 1894 to 1947, or up to say 1935, because after 1935 you had provincial governments, you will rarely come across a case where the landowner is deprived of compensation or delaying compensation. Go through. It is after 1947 when we became independent that the landowners became servants and the politicians became masters. The whole administrative setup underwent a qualitative change in the sense it deteriorated its standards. One of the good things that the Britishers did, and that is why they could rule over us, that the administration which was touching the common man was never corrupt. But moment the independence came, it was terrible. This is the unfortunate part. We cannot forget this fact. Now secondly, now we need to devise, there would be a few marginal cases where the poor man is not paid his compensation. First of all, your contention about Section 17, I entirely agree with you, and for that, the courts are responsible. The Supreme Court held, and according to me, that's one of the wrong judgments delivered by this, that if the acquisition is through Section 17, that is urgency clause, Section 11A does not apply. Wholly incorrect view. You are defeating the very purpose of 11A. That's one point. Second point, that in a Section 17 mechanism, inherently there is no fault. Because suppose we need to prepare for defense. Now you can't go through Section 4, Section 5A, Section 6, all that. See, there are purposes. Of course, this power has been misused. And the courts, unfortunately, according to me, have been too liberal, have been too kind to the administration. This is where... Now see the recent judgment in Scheduled Caste, Scheduled Tribe. It's an eye-opener. What do they say? That if there is no prima facie case of an offence under that act, then the anticipatory bail will lie. Correct? That's the view taken. Because they say fundamental right is paramount, and therefore it will override, almost they say, they don't say that the section is bad, but they say it almost overrides. Now why that principle was not applied in case of 17? because 19(1)(f) went in 78. So till 1978, you had right to hold property as a fundamental right, and look at the judgments of here. So therefore, in a situation like that, but it is only in last 10 years that the courts have become so active that they have almost taken over all the functions of the government.
Anyone? Problem? Please.
My question is about the consent. You see, when there is no consensus on the definition of development itself, so what sound is seeking consent of the people? You see, there is something you see. There can be a number of people who are not, you see, facilitated by this development. So why any development should be imposed on them?
Oh, very good question. Acceptance of this argument would tantamount to denial of the existence of the state. We have in constitutional law a concept of sovereignty. Though in Indian context, the sovereignty is partly with legislature, partly with the court, partly with the executive. But the essential attribute of a sovereign state is its capacity to enact laws, to implement development projects, to protect the life and liberty of the citizens. These are elementary functions of any civilized society which gets itself transformed into a state. Now therefore, if the state has to take individual's consent for development, that's the end of sovereignty.
I have a caveat, sir. In Delhi and around Delhi, lands were acquired for ridiculously low prices for, let us say, DLF projects, which was private. In South Extension, in which today the land is at 2 lakhs per square meter, it was acquired for 50 paise per square meter for DLF projects. So some protection is essential, that after all the landowner must get his due. If not rehabilitation and the price of his land, that was not secured, and all the courts have upheld those awards, those, because probably they were not aware of the potential is also one of the factors to be taken into account. South Extension was after all in the heart of the city.
I can answer your question. I prefer to answer it not as a lawyer, but as a student of political science. My experience tells me that in any society, there are powerful groups. They are economically powerful, they are politically powerful, they have the muscle power, they have the financial power, and every new law is manipulated by such groups. Banks were nationalized in 1969. You look at the statement and object of reason. To give easy credit to someone who wants to start a taxi, some lady who wants to start some small enterprise. And look at, you have now Nirav Modi taking away 40,000 crores from one of the nationalized banks. Now this is a problem which is endemic, especially to a corrupt society like India. I feel sometimes ashamed. Now everybody in the institution has failed. What was RBI doing? What was Finance Ministry doing? What was the Standing Committee on various ministries of Parliament doing?
Shame.
It's a shame. It's a national shame. Now, in every such situation, the powerful groups, whether you call them land sharks, land mafia, by any name, they know how to exploit the system. And it's the answer to your problem lies more outside the realm of law and lies more in some other arena.
Oh, adversity to fight.
Please. Stand up, please stand.
In acquisition under section 17, invoking urgency clause, don't you think so? In that case also, 5 years required to be given, because our experience shows many a times Section 17 was invoked, but land is still lying vacant for years to get.
That's you hold the courts responsible. I hold courts responsible because they have been too liberal and too kind.
Yeah.
Now I'll give you one example.
Yes.
Now in that cantonment matter, I think Justice Chavan said, just go through that, find out, where there was no hearing like 5A, but his lordship has read into it. Now look at the consequences what has happened is. As a result of that judgment, I am just showing the other side of the story. The public authorities were saddled with an additional cost of 40 to 50,000 crores. On simple right of hearing. You see that judgment. I often say that this is where the judicial aberration lies. Where there is a conscious omission of the right of hearing. Because you have a constitutional remedy of going to the court. How do you read into it? And look at the consequence. The doctrine of prospective overruling you could have applied. Why not? Because such a situation arose, the administrator goes by law, it doesn't contemplate hearing. Now after 10 years you say that therefore the whole acquisition goes and refix the compensation, imposing. There are several problems. And one characteristic which I found in the working of the Supreme Court is never consistent.
Any questions? Please, last question. Okay.
Sir,
I request,
please.
Sir,
which is the best book on administrative law these days?
If you want to know the analytical approach, it is the English books, Wade, Smith.
Wade is still available.
It's available. An Indian book, a small book written by Professor Sathe, who was the principal of law college in Pune. His book is, but nobody has edited that book, at least to my knowledge. Dr. Sathe passed away. And the, if you want some digest, you have Jain on administrative law.
Basu Jain and
but Justice Thakkar's book on administrative law can also is equally good.
Just one question.
Yes, sir.
24-2 that we are discussing. The legislature consciously uses or when it knew that it could have used and. I would think that it used the word or. Now, in an attempt to humanize the system where, as he pointed out, acquisition is made and their possession is not taken, probably the legislature wanted such situations to be covered. Evidently, you don't need an acquisition. For 5 years, if you have not taken possession, what does it mean? And therefore, I think when they said or, they said either, and not really and, not it's disjunctive and not conjunctive. Otherwise, no, I should think, as you we said earlier, it spoke what it meant and meant what it spoke. With the full option to use the word, use the expression and, they used or, and then I think they were trying to humanize the law of acquisition by saying, if you don't want it for 5 years, you can return the money and give it to him. Because he becomes entitled for the appreciation, therefore. So, in many places I hear this argument that it is not either or there is and. And which I think, according to me, runs against the grain of the attempt to humanize the acquisition. I just thought.
So, possible view. See, ultimately, all questions of law depend upon the value judgment of the judge himself. If he is pro-property, he will take a particular view. If he is pro-public, and we see it daily in the court.
So, I should believe that's the aberration.
But an answer to this, in some of the European countries, there is another method, that is method of escalation. See, unfortunately, we freeze it to Section 4, or we freeze it to Section 11 under the new Act. There they have that as long as the process of acquisition goes on, either by payment or by taking possession, the appreciation in the real estate prices, the landowner must get the benefit. That kind of law is required to be introduced. This kind of defective drafting is... See, I am neither pro-property owners nor am I pro-government. I see a project, because if admittedly if it is a public purpose project, then how much do you impose the cost on the... Because some individuals do suffer, and that's the inevitable in any process of development. People, farmers are uprooted because there has to be irrigation. Now, it is difficult for an uprooted family to go elsewhere and settle. But then you see the larger public interest. Now, the example which I gave you of Justice Chauhan judgment, look at 40,000-50,000 crores. Now, another case which I argued, on a similar reasoning, the cost would have been to a small township 18,000 crores. And I told the judge, look, this is what it is. The provision is capable of interpretation both ways. The learned judge, for one reason or the other, didn't want to decide. He said, I remand the matter to the High Court. But these are issues which are required to, because ultimately the nation pays, no? So in any acquisition process, it is the rights of an individual versus the larger public interest. And the conflict between the two is as old as human civilization. All that we can do is to find alternatives to the system, try to improve. But the basic flaw lies in the administration. As Dr. Ambedkar said on the last day of the Constituent Assembly, his words were prophetic. Our Law Day is 26th November, that is the last day on which the Constituent Assembly met. And he made a very prophetic statement that we have tried to give a good constitution to the people of India. But even a good constitution will not work if bad people are in government. And if good people in the government, even a bad constitution will work. See Dr. Ambedkar, how prophetic he was. Well, this is what it is. There is no ultimately no solution to improving the quality of the administration.
Okay, so now I request Subodh Markandeya, senior advocate, will give you a vote of thanks.
On behalf of my colleagues and on my own behalf, I thank you for a very illuminating lecture on the land acquisition, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. It was my pleasure.
Yeah, thank you. Autograph here, sir.
It's good that you are maintaining some record also.
Yeah, otherwise it's a...
It's actual record, sir.